The Wheel of Time weaves a great pattern of the ages, where every thread is a person, event, or detail of this incredibly complex epic fantasy universe created by Robert Jordan. It's my job to unravel it. Welcome to Unraveling the Pattern. I'm Lauren, and this is my first deep dive about the Wheel of Time TV show on Amazon Prime. Can you believe it's finally here? In the future, I'll be making individual episode deep dives, but since they released the first three at once, this is what you get. For this reason, this video will also be a bit longer than normal. Please remember to like the video if you like the video, and please subscribe for more content like this. If you're one of these people who watches without subscribing, you might be a dark friend, or worse, a white cloak. Let's get into it. Spoiler warning. This video contains spoilers for the first three episodes of the Wheel of Time TV show on Amazon Prime Video. Some minor details related to changes between the first book and the show will also be discussed, but you don't need to have read the first Wheel of Time book or the series to watch this video. Robert Jordan's The Wheel of Time is about a lot of things. Like, a lot. You don't write 14 massive volumes and a prequel novel as well as two companion books about nothing. In the first three episodes of the TV show, we get mentions of over 70 new terms, names, and locations. Believe me, I counted. Each of the 14 Wheel of Time books has a glossary at the end filled with definitions, just to help the reader follow all of the complexities of the series. There are over 2,780 named characters in the Wheel of Time books. Amazon Prime Video has created bonus animations and a ton of supplementary materials through their Explore and X-Ray bonus content sections that explain various terms and characters and locations to new viewers, just like the glossaries at the back of each Wheel of Time book. I myself have created an ever-expanding series of videos called WOT 101 that aims to educate new fans about certain complex details of this new and exciting world. Please go and check them out. Needless to say, it's a lot. But beyond new terms and faces, the themes of the books and show are rich and deep as well. Themes like duty versus desire, gender dynamics, duality, balance and imbalance, life, death, and rebirth, light and shadow, love and hate, and heartbreak and trauma and coping, good versus evil, and what it means to be a hero or a villain, the unreliable narrator, misinformation and corruption of history over time, and so much more. Much like the great pattern that is woven by the Wheel of Time to make up this epic fantasy world, all of these threads, themes, and details combine together to create a beautifully complex tapestry. So when somebody asks me, what's the Wheel of Time about? Most often my answer is, where do I even start? And now Amazon Prime and Sony Pictures, with Rafe Judkins at the helm as the showrunner, have begun the monumental task of adapting this beloved book series into a television show. In many ways, it seems like an impossible mountain to climb, even if it seems as though they've spared no expense. But does it live up to the story it was based on? Rafe Judkins has been preparing us as fans for over 2 years now, warning that there would be changes and that we should, quote, gird our loins. He said, "What's special about the first book, The Eye of the World, is the themes of balance, of gender, and the emotional journey of these characters. As a fan of the books, I feel so lucky we get to bring this world to life." He also said, "My job is to protect the spine and heart of what's there." And now we've seen the first three episodes, with five more to come before season one ends. There have been many opinions shared by those who call themselves book purists, and by those who are often called shills if they share positive thoughts about the show. Review bombing is alive and well on many review sites, and fans of the books who want to see this TV series make it to the end are concerned for various reasons. Robert Jordan, the author of the Wheel of Time books, should be applauded for creating such a dedicated and loyal fan base, despite the fact that often we don't all seem to agree or get along. The fact that everyone who invested so much time into reading this series treats it with such respect and reverence that they feel the need to protect their headcanon or to defend the books is really a tribute to Robert Jordan's brilliant work. But the show is here, and just like the books, it now exists. Certain elements can no longer be changed. If you ask a room of 100 Wheel of Time fans what they would change about the books, you'd likely get 100 different answers. All things in these books certainly don't please all people, and the show won't be able to do that either. The real question is, does the Wheel of Time TV show truly deliver on Rafe's promise to stay true to the heart and spine of the books? Despite plot, story, or character changes, or removal of some important elements and additions of others, do the emotional journeys of these characters feel reminiscent of or true to their book counterparts? After having watched the first three episodes, I would argue that yes, this is the Wheel of Time. It's just another turning of the wheel. And according to author Brandon Sanderson, who wrote the final three volumes of the book series, he agrees. In the Wheel of Time universe, the Wheel of Time turns and ages come and pass and come again. With the repeat of a previous age, some minor events and beats change, but the heart and soul of the people and themes remain the same. The spine is intact. Some Some threads in the tapestry might be different up close, but in my opinion, from a distance, the great pattern of this age looks the same as its previous iteration. Instead of Emmons Field, we just get the two rivers in this turning. We get matches and a matchbox right in the beginning, even though they haven't yet been invented at this point in the books. We still see glimpses of a more advanced world from long ago. At first, I was confused by how these buildings could still be standing after 3,000 years, but then I remembered that during the previous age, the One Power was used for everything, including architecture, so surely it would take longer for these buildings to crumble and for these highways to disappear. In the books, Moraine knows the sex and the birthplace of the dragon, but in this turning, it seems to be less clear. Instead of dead rats, we get dead bats. Does this prove that Rand is actually Batman? In the place of simple Aes Sedai great serpent rings that all look the same, we get larger versions with colored gems that identify the Aja or faction to which each Aes Sedai belongs, but it also makes for a more visually recognizable icon for a television adaptation. Beltane is more than a springtime celebration where villagers put flowers on the graves of those who are gone. It's more focused on contemplating the loss of loved ones and for praying to the light that they might find their way back home when the wheel of time spins them back out to be reincarnated again. Instead of the attack on Winter Night happening off-screen, we get to see it in full force with even more destruction. The evil of Shadar-Logoth, Mashadar, is no longer mindless tendrils of white fog, but instead is a seemingly sentient predator of darkness that consumes any living thing that it touches. Many little details or threads of the tapestry are certainly shifted, changed, removed, or rearranged, but to me, the heart and spine of the books are there. And what about the characters? Instead of grizzled old Tom Marilyn in Emmons Field with a multicolored patch-covered cloak, a harp, and a voice of a court bard, we get younger adoptive father Tom Marilyn in Breen's Spring with a guitar and a gravelly voice reminiscent of Eddie Vedder. The patches are still there, but downplayed. The imbalance of genders is more apparent so far in the show as well, with Marin Alvear appearing to be the innkeeper instead of her husband Bran, who is the innkeeper and mayor in the books. The innkeeper in Breen's Spring is also a female. Although Rand calls her a barmaid, she seems to be the one in charge. And Isla appears to be the seeker, or leader of the traveling people instead of her husband, Rayan, who was the head of this group of the Tuatha On, more commonly known as Tinkers, in a previous turning of the wheel. In the books, Rand, Matt, Perrin, and Egwene are younger and less experienced, but in the show we get slightly older versions of them who have already lost their virginity and who come from slightly different backgrounds. But I believe their core character traits are not only intact, but in many ways improved. Rand is still the responsible sheepherder who puts his duty above his desires. His work ethic shines through as he picks up the rocks that dropped on the road without being asked, or when he does the dishes without complaint. Though angry at his situation, he still gathers wood for the fire. He works overtime to chop wood just for a place to sleep in the dirt. Rand cares deeply for those he knows and stays true to Egwene despite the flirtations of a pretty girl, even though his future with Egwene is uncertain. He offers money to his struggling friend Matt, and he carries a strawberry in his pocket for Egwene all day. He still wants a simple life in the Two Rivers, where he can raise a family in peace. He's still stubborn as a mule and obstinate when Moraine is unclear about her intentions. He quickly takes charge when things seem tough with Matt after the group is separated at Shadar-Logoth. He still listens to his father's teachings and reminisces about his mother who died when he was little. Tam says, in a very endearing way, that Rand's mother liked to drink. Who was she? Do you think we'll learn more about her? Rand still follows his heart when deciding which way to go to find Egwene. Like his book counterpart, Rand always manages to find inner strength when he needs it most. He surprises Dana with his goodness and loyalty to Egwene, and he shocks her even more when he finds the strength to break down the thick door that Dana said three men Rand's size couldn't break. This scene in particular felt reminiscent of a certain escape from a storage room in a dirty inn at Four Kings. Book readers know what I'm talking about. It's just another turning. Perrin is still the quiet and considerate blacksmith, but now due to his traumatic event in this turning, we have a reason to understand why he is so careful and cautious around others. We understand why he is so protective of Egwene. We understand why he labors to fight his inner beast that, when unchecked, causes him to go into a sort of berserker rage. We understand why he struggles with choosing the axe when he wants to be a man of peace and to choose the hammer that his wife chose, because it's a tool, not a weapon. Notice that Layla fights with the hammer and Perrin with the axe. They even portrayed this in some of the concept art that you can find in the bonus features section on Amazon Prime Video. In many ways, Perrin's hesitancy to accept certain aspects about himself make more sense because of his new backstory. I find it interesting that Layla Han Solo'd Perrin when he told her he loved her, and she simply responded with, "I know." Why do you think she didn't attend Egwene's ceremony? Are her scars the result of work in the forge? Or is it something more sinister? Perrin is fiercely loyal, almost to a fault, just like a lovesick wolf pup. Why is Layla sad and distant? Is she pregnant, or did she suffer from a miscarriage, or are they perhaps unable to conceive as a couple? Could she be jealous of Egwene for some reason? Is she just angry that Perrin was out partying while there was work to be done in the forge? After all, iron is hard to work alone. I find it endearing that in each scene where they have a moment together, Layla does cuddle up close to Perrin, and she grabs his pinky finger. I wonder if we'll learn more about that in a flashback in a future episode. She seems to truly enjoy herself as they dance together at Beltane. Do you believe the wild theory that Layla could actually be a dark friend, and that's why she was so forlorn on Winter Night? Did she perhaps know what was coming, or was she given instructions to kill Perrin or to turn him over to the Dark One's minions? I don't know if I buy this theory, but there is some evidence for this. When Perrin swings the axe towards her after the Trolloc is clearly dead, she has her arms raised with the hammer as if she's about to strike Perrin. There's a growling sound as if Perrin is either being warned by something or his beastly nature is showing through. Perhaps because of her dark oaths, Layla does not feel like she can tell Perrin that she loves him, but perhaps she did come to care for him and was trying to put him out of his misery, knowing that the Dark One wanted him. Perhaps she's been visited by the Shadow with glowing eyes in her dreams, just like Dana. And in Perrin's dreams, the wolf appears to be an enemy from his point of view, or possibly a metaphor for what Perrin did when he killed his wife. But what if the wolf is actually killing her in the dream to try and protect Perrin from her or from the glowing-eyed specter? Speaking of the wolves, why did this one lick Perrin's wound? And why did the wolves shepherd Perrin and Egwene towards the Tinkers? Are the wolves working to help, or are they a threat, possibly working for the Dark One? One more thing about Perrin. I like how he was the first to notice that there were no bugs or birds in Shadar Logoth, as if his senses are more enhanced than the others. Matt Cawthon was the village prankster in his younger years, often getting himself and his two friends into trouble. But in the show, he's so much more than the comic relief, though his one-liners have been great so far. Unlike his book counterpart, he now comes from a broken home and cares more for the well-being of his sisters and hopes that he will not become like his deadbeat father, while ironically falling into many of his father's same traps. What did Matt do to acquire the bracelet from Danya? Did he use his charming prankster smile to get her to consent to give it to him, or was it something more sinister? The way he and Pat and Fane interact, it feels as though he likely stole it. Pat and Fane asks him if he could even resell it in the village, knowing full well that he cannot. He gives Matt 3 Beltane lanterns and sends him on his way. Matt doesn't always make the right choices, but he almost always does the right thing in the end. When given money by his friends, he doesn't tell them that he already has purchased lanterns for himself and his sisters, but it seems as though he ended up using the extra money to purchase additional lanterns for his mother and father. When he discovers his sisters missing during the Winter Night attack, he faces his fear, and though paralyzed by it at first, he does what's right and runs into the metaphorical burning building to find his sisters, ensuring their safety. Matt is still the trickster with a heart of gold whose luck seems to constantly be running out. Tom recognizes this in Matt almost immediately when they meet, and again later when they bury the Aielmen. Tom recognizes when two young men from far away are in over their heads. He allows Matt the opportunity to steal from the dead Aielmen before burying him with honor. He talks of the oddity of red hair outside of the Aiel Waste, which is far away to the east, but he recognizes that Rand and Matt are clearly from the Two Rivers to the west, based on their accents, their clothing, and their stubborn attitudes. Surely he noticed Rand's red hair. And like a helicopter parent, Tom hovers around, keeping an eye on them and protecting them from themselves and from Dark Friends. He's always got a throwing knife up his sleeve. Like his book counterpart, Tom seems to know much about the world, and he observes everything around him. How much did Tom overhear when Dana the Dark Friend told Rand and Matt that one of the 5 people from the Two Rivers was the Dragon Reborn? Could Tom be familiar with the prophecies of the dragon? Tom's sad song can be interpreted in many ways. It seems to tell the story of a man from long ago who was once called the dragon and broke the world. But what if Tom's song is also about someone from his own past, or about the Dragon Reborn from this age? I'll discuss this in more detail in another video. Back to Matt. Matt might not admit it openly, but he does love and care for his friends. I found this scene very endearing. Matt gives Perrin a dagger that Layla made for him to keep Perrin and those Matt loves safe in case they ever got into trouble. But don't worry, Matt quickly found a replacement dagger in Shadar Logoth. Speaking of Shadar Logoth, why didn't the Trollocs want to enter the city? You can see this one literally backing away as if afraid to even get too close. Why would they be afraid to enter a place called Shadow's Waiting? Don't the Trollocs and Fays work for the Shadow? Notice too that the ground in the city is covered in dark dust that looks similar to the ash from this dying horse. Are they walking over the leftover debris of of the dead from ages past? Is this why there are no bugs or birds? Does the city consume every living thing that enters? The sound design in Shadarlogoth was also oddly quiet and muffled, and it was mentioned somewhere that the set was intentionally built to look like there were eyes everywhere. Did you notice also the eerie whistling sound that happened just as the shadows of the city began to creep out? This same whistling tune was heard earlier in episode 1, when the Fade was shown for the first time, and Padan Fain was whistling the same tune in the following scene as he entered the Two Rivers with his peddler wagon. And what was the shadowy figure that led Matt to the dagger? Is this the same shadow that we've seen with glowing eyes in Rand and Perrin's dreams? Or could this be someone or something else? If this is the character I think it is from the books, how was it able to cast a shadow? Once again, it's another turning. Remember when Lan told them not to touch anything in the city? What will happen to Matt if he keeps this ruby-hilted dagger that he found there? Did you notice how his personality slightly shifted from being very supportive of Rand, telling him he promises that they'll find Egwene and Perrin, but later he tells Rand they're probably dead and even if they aren't, Egwene wouldn't go searching for Rand? Rand echoes Matt's mother's sentiment that he's just a prick like his father, but something is affecting Matt's attitude, bringing out the meaner nature of his father that Matt tries to avoid. Perhaps Matt feels some hope when Dana shares her sentiments about being someone else and getting out of the dirt from whence she came. Egwene is still the ambitious chameleon that we love from the books, who adapts and learns from everyone with whom she comes in contact. Like Belle from Beauty and the Beast, she wants much more than her provincial life. Egwene loves Rand, but also has aspirations of her own, and makes choices for herself. She's not selfish, but driven. Truthfully, she understands that her ambitions do not fit in with what Rand desires, and that they would both likely be better off without each other. Egwene is told that as a woman, she's always alone, and yet never alone. She almost seems to carry the weight of the world around her shoulders. When Nynaeve tells her she can listen to the wind, she catches on so quickly and senses the evil and wrongness that whispers through the trees. And when Moraine tells her she can channel the One Power and that the wind will actually listen to her, Egwene immediately shows promise, even after her first lesson, causing Moraine's Ki Sierra stone to flicker with light. Later, she manages to start a fire just when she and Perrin need it most. When the traveling people tell her what words to say as part of their greeting ritual, she struggles but manages to say it back word for word. She's a quick learner, and she's as bright as her aspirations to be something more than a serving girl or a housewife in a backwater village. She's also caring and non-judgmental of people who have struggles or who are different from her. She comforts Perrin when they're struggling, and she accepts the traveling people in stride. Nynaeve is the strongest person she knows how to be on the outside and tells Egwene to be strong, but clearly she deals with internal insecurities and passionate emotions that she struggles to sometimes keep in check. She's a protector and a teacher, a leader and a fighter. When Trollocs yell at her, Nynaeve yells right back. And when one threatens to kill her, she makes use of her terrain to hide and then strikes at it fiercely with its own sword. Did you catch the Dragonfang symbol in this scene? When a mysterious Aes Sedai enters her village, she puts up walls around herself and those she cares for and snaps back. Her rage seems to be just on the surface most of the time. She does not take Moraine's compliment that she truly is qualified to be the wisdom as anything other than an insult. Yet despite her frustrations with, and possibly even hatred towards Lan and Moraine, she steps up and finds healing herbs and creates an ointment to help ease Moraine's pain and to give her needed energy. Lan trusts her, even after she tries to kill him, knowing she'll do what she must to help Moraine. Even after Lan leaves her alone and she threatens not to stick around, when we again see her, she isn't just watching over Moraine, but she's tending to her wound. Did you catch that Moraine whispered the name Swan in this scene? We'll learn more about Swan in a future episode. When others burn lamps to attract the spirits of their loved ones, hoping the wheel will spin them back out close by, Nynaeve finds herself truly alone and weeps. Is she weeping for a lost loved one, like the wisdom who raised and trained her, or the parents she lost as a baby? Or does she cry because of her insecurities as the too young, supposedly unqualified village wisdom? When Nynaeve weeps, she does not receive the comfort or support of the other members of the village, despite the fact that she told Egwene that a woman is never alone. And when surrounded by the dark, with no light in sight, she can feel her braid to give her strength. Nynaeve has no one to comfort her, like the others do. As Rand said, the life of a wisdom is truly a lonely one. Perhaps this is why she tugs at her braids so often, to remind herself that she is not truly alone. But, true to Nynaeve, she wipes away her tears and clears her throat so no one will see, and she puts her walls back up before re-entering the Beltane celebration. She doesn't even participate in the dancing, because that would not be proper for a village wisdom. It is in these quiet moments from the first three episodes that the heart and the spine of the books and characters shine through the brightest. In many ways, I think the show has done a better job of setting up the character motivations than the books did. To me, they are the Emmonsfield Five now. And what of Lan and Moraine? To me, Daniel Henney captures the heart and spine of Land very well, but he also adds refreshing humanity to his character that's not quite as present early on in the books. Land is stoic when he's in public, but more open when alone with Moraine. He's ever loyal to his Aes Sedai, protecting her at all costs. He's openly surprised by Nynaeve's ability to track him, but he also tells her she knows nothing of the world and is able to tie her up with little effort. I love seeing Land constantly scouting ahead or behind and bringing information to Moraine only as it was pertinent. I do wish we had seen more of him training the young people to use their weapons as he does in the books. But through that stony exterior, you see how deeply he cares for his Aes Sedai. And Nynaeve sees this tender side of him too. Matt even calls attention to the fact that Lan spoke more sentences in Shadow Logoth than he had in the past several days, maybe ever. To me, Daniel Henney is the perfect embodiment of Lan, and not just because I've seen his butt. Moraine is ever the serene Aes Sedai. She's driven by causes, as every Blue Sister is. And it shows. What did she mean by rumors of Four Ta'veren and the Two Rivers? I'll discuss Ta'veren in greater detail in another video, but to me, the only way this line can make any sort of sense is if somehow Moraine has already been in contact with a certain someone who can read the pattern. Otherwise, it's my least favorite line in the first three episodes. Back to Moraine. She's patient enough to watch and listen and wait for the pattern to give her what she needs, but she also doesn't just wait around for the wheel to weave as it wills. She questions Nynaeve about her age and origin, and while Nynaeve thinks she's there to insult her, Moraine is actually using the process of elimination to determine whether or not Nynaeve is the actual prophesied dragon reborn. Moraine and Lan were clear that the dragon was reborn 20 years ago, and yet Nynaeve reveals that she's 25 or 26. You can almost see Moraine mentally checking Nynaeve off of her list at that moment. And true to her character in the books, Moraine lectures about the importance of words and the three oaths, including the oath to speak no word that is not true. And then she masterfully uses Aes Sedai trickery to skirt the truth and escape the wrath of the White Cloaks. When Egwene calls her on it, she uses it as another lesson. Aes Sedai don't always say the truth you think you hear. Egwene absorbs this lesson like a sponge, filing it away in her ever-growing bag of tricks. This is a great use of show, not tell in the writing. The audience learns about the Aes Sedai and how they skirt the oaths to which they are bound without it feeling like too much info dumping on us all at once. And true to character, Rand and Matt don't like hearing any of it. Lan takes it all in stride and Perrin continues to brood. Moraine falls into the same traps as her book counterpart, sharing just enough info to keep the Two Rivers people in check, but not enough really to help them understand what's going on. Egwene defends Moraine in perfect form. Are you convinced yet that while some story beats are different, the characters and the main plot arcs are true to their book counterparts? And that the tapestry is nearly identical from a distance? And what of the themes? The imbalance between genders is clear. The pendulum has swung too far the other way, and the pattern is in need of course correction. The Andrin falsely assumes that the One Power is only for women, and that when men touch it, they make it filthy. But that isn't the case at all, as I'm sure we'll soon learn. And those who call themselves the Children of the Light, referred to by others as White Cloaks, claim moral superiority, and yet they're often led by zealots who believe that brutality is somehow mercy. I like that Jefferon Bornhold was a little more sane, and that he told Moraine to find an Aes Sedai to heal her wound. Even in these small moments, the themes and characters are spot on for me. I know some people think this is out of character for a White Cloak, but I disagree. Jefferon Bornhold is not a character who is overzealous like many of the other Children of the Light. As Jess from the Ammerlin Study put it on Twitter, he's out to find dark friends. He's not on a witch hunt like Valda and the Questioners. The motivations of those who follow the Dark One as it is presented in the show are more clear and make more sense to me as well. To be honest, I never understood why anyone would want to be a dark friend as it is described in the books, but the show clarifies that. It isn't just about power or glory or promises of immortality, though I'm sure Dana, the Dark Friend, would have liked to see Matt and Rand kneeling to her, and she clearly likes the thought of receiving the glory of being the one to bring the dragon to the Dark One, but it's more about breaking free of the endless misery that life has to offer. She doesn't want to live in the dirt anymore, or to be reborn to suffer. She wants to get out to see the Stone of Tyr, or the Lion Throne in Camelot, or an Ogier Steading, or maybe even a Trolloc. The dragon has the potential to be the savior for the light or the dark. Who the dragon is and what the dragon will do remains a mystery, and I'm loving it. I love that the first episode ends with the classic opening line from every book about the wheel of time turning and ages coming and passing, and about the wind that rises in the mountains of mist. If it is true that one of these characters leaving the Two Rivers in this scene is the dragon, then we're seeing the dragon literally riding on the winds of time. There's so much more, quite impressively packed into these first three episodes, that I'll have to discuss in future videos, like the weaves of the One Power and Moraine's Angreal, metaphors of rivers and surrendering, hidden symbols of the dragon's fang and the blood on the rocks, the history of Manethrin and Eridol during the Trolloc Wars, the war in Gaeldon, Loghain, the Old Blood, and so much more. And yet the show also gives the emotional journeys of these characters time to breathe on screen. The first three episodes certainly aren't perfect. They have some real pacing issues, especially the first episode, which felt to me like it was made by committee and that many Amazon executives had their fingers all over it. To me, the first episode would have done better to be 10 to 15 minutes longer. I personally hope that Rafe is given more creative freedom as the show progresses. For those of us who are book fans, many might feel as though they rushed or butchered our characters' backstories, or that they didn't include enough detail, but it is a beginning, and I feel that as the show finds its legs, it really does have the potential to be great. I truly believe the heart and spine of the books are still there. But, like the Wheel, let's cycle back. As I asked in the beginning, what is the Wheel of Time really about? When Rand asks his father how long it takes for the Wheel of Time to turn someone's spirit back into the world again, Tam says something that resonated deeply with me and feels even more true to the themes of the entire series than the first book. He says, "Wish I knew, but I'm sure there's a reason no one can remember their previous lives. All we can do is the best we can with the life that's given to us, and take comfort from it, that no matter what happens, what pain we face, what heartbreak, even death, the wheel keeps turning, always, and we try again, maybe do a little better than the last time." Thank you to my patrons who support me and what I do on this channel. Please consider joining here on YouTube or on Patreon to support me, and don't forget to like and subscribe. In the future, I'll do individual episode-specific breakdown videos, but with three rapid-fire episodes last week, I felt the need to address the bigger tapestry as we enter this incredible journey again as longtime readers or for the first time as new fans. Remember, no matter what happens, the wheel keeps turning.